10,000 crore rupees to the sale of assets. 5 properties in Mumbai, Chennai and Delhi to go on the block. Funds to be used to retire debts.
What a signal it's going to be now, just a week ahead of the budget. The central bank has released the final guidelines as far as bank licenses are concerned. As I said, India Inc. has been waiting very, very closely to see if they will finally be eligible or not to apply for one. Whether they will get one is another story altogether. But let's go across now to Lata Venkatesh. She's gone through the fine print. Lata, what are you picking up?
Well, certainly it is stricter, and whatever looks easy in terms of allowing all promoter groups, irrespective of their exposure, is more an overarching statement. First things first, corporate groups with any other kind of exposures, real estate, broking, will be allowed, no conditions there, but very strict conditions in terms of quality. They should be promoters of integrity and sound financial credentials, and the promoter group's business model should not be misaligned with the bank culture or a banking model, and they should not have extraordinary exposure in speculative activities and assets which have high price volatility. I would read that as real estate, but clearly it's camouflaged. There are a lot of conditions on exactly how even the holding company of the banking license will be constituted. No one individual within that holding company can hold more than 10% in the holding company, and 51% will be held by group companies which in turn will have 51% public shareholding. So even that holding company is thought to be widely held. In terms of how much the promoter group will have control over the bank, a minimum of 40% initially when it is floated, but within 3 years it should come down to 40%. In 3 years it should be listed. In 10 years come down to 20%, and in 12 years to 15%. So hopes that a minimum 26% will be allowed have been washed away, but it is still better than the current 10% which the promoter group has to come down to. In terms of the kind of exposure, kind of responsibilities, minimum 25% of all new branches will have to be in unbanked areas, and that will create quite a strain on profitability. There are also very stringent exposures on the holding company and where it can invest. It will have to set aside 25% into of its profit into a reserve fund which will be used for the bank as well. Obviously the bank and the holding company cannot have any exposure either through bonds or through actual loans to any of the group companies. Those are the broad rules, not making it look very profitable, at least in the initial 3 to 5 years.
Alright, Lata, I appreciate you joining us with the details and the fine print of the guidelines that were put out by the Reserve Bank of India on bank licenses this evening. We've been getting a whole host of reactions here on CNBC TV 18. Let's just listen into what the former Banking Secretary DK Mittal and a whole host of others had to tell us on the channel.
The purpose of bringing out these guidelines and inviting the private sector into banking was that we want a huge amount of investment to come into this sector. That's point number one. At the same time, banking is an extremely sensitive sector. It is not a sector where you can have reckless players entering and playing around with people's money. So all kinds of safeguards that have been built in have been thought of very carefully, and I think there's a purpose behind each one of them.
Sir, yep.
Now, hang on. And if, as you said, a safeguard is a deterrent, then maybe the safeguard is serving its purpose.
I think this was an agreed understanding between the government and the RBI that we should not disqualify any class of business entities as an issue. Because in each class of entities, there could be very good entities, there could be bad entities. It is for the RBI as a regulator to see that which entities are good, which should be considered, and which entities are not, they're not to be considered. And that's a very fair way of moving forward.
I hope that there is a level playing field. If there is a level playing field, then I do not think that one should worry about public sector, private sector, everybody coming into the play. Secondly, if there is a very restricted numbers of licenses if they are going to issue, then of course it will become something which will constrict the number of players who can come in. So that's where I hope that RBI will be liberal on that subject, and then thereafter it will be survival of the fittest.
I really welcome these guidelines. They really reflect a very deep and erudite thinking on part of the Reserve Bank of India, particularly not excluding ab initio some of the, you know, corporate houses with exposure in the real estate and brokerage sectors is a very, very welcome step indeed. And the guidelines on the whole are going to go a long way in promoting the cause of financial inclusion and overall deepening of the financial sector. So we really welcome it.
Well, a bunch of reactions are coming into the guidelines released by the Reserve Bank of India. Let me go across to my guest, now Sunil Godwani. Up until now, you said let the Reserve Bank release its guidelines and then we'll let you know whether we will be in the race, whether we will apply or not. On the basis of what you've heard this evening, are you going to apply?
Yes, we will. We are going to apply, and the guidelines have created a very level playing field, which is a very positive move from RBI. I think it clearly states that everybody is eligible, and they will decide who is not eligible. And they have kept a very broad arena. There's a lot of elbow room with them, and anybody who has an aspiration to be an ethical bank, to have a good set of financially strong promoters, and comply with the financial inclusion other guidelines, and who has still got an experience of running a financial service business, because they do say you got to have a 10-year experience in there. So it's not, you know, you got to have a background of financial services, sort of matured in the industry, seen the ups and downs of the market, be emotionally strong to handle it. Looks very positive.
But in terms of the operating holding company structure, are you in agreement with the fact that that is going to be feasible for people like you to be able to put together? And I know that in the run-up to your being able to apply for the bank license, you did try and ring-fence yourself already. So are you better placed than most people in that sense to be able to apply on the 1st of July?
We would like to think so, but I think we'll still have to evaluate it out, understand exactly what are the details in this, because the nomenclature has changed now. It's not a non-operative holding company, it's a non-operative financial holding company.
Yeah.
And we like to see what does that impact. And if any further structuring is required, one will have to evaluate it out from the economics of the business, because it's just not being a bank. It has to be financially, economically viable at the end of the day to provide value to the shareholders.
But the fact that you are allowed 40% in the first 5 years and then you need to bring your stake down even eventually to 15% over 12 years. Do you believe that that is fair? Do you believe that that is going to be something that you will be able to comply with?
This point, I think is very fair. I mean, they're clearly wanting to give a message out that the banks will not be promoter control. There'll be a governance structure in place, an independent majority, independent board. The shareholding will be there. At the same time, you are the promoter. So you will be called upon to come in and provide capital for the bank in an adversity situation. So very clearly, you're designated promoter, but you don't have strong influence over the company, over the bank, as if you own it in a manner of sense. So I think it differentiates between ownership and management, which is positive.
Enough safeguards, Pramod Basin, to avoid the moral hazard in that sense?
Too many, I think. You know, too many. I think, you know, tweaking all these shareholding arrangements and doing all of that, I don't think necessarily works. If you look around the history
of this world. But globally, that's exactly how it works.
Well, not really. In terms of, if you think of private banks that have worked quite well for years, if you think about ownership in banks that have worked quite well.
And then we saw 2008.
But who did it affect? All the ones who were really public. That's the point I'm making, is that being public, for instance, is no safeguard. So I think RBI, I actually think RBI is a remarkable institution which has done remarkably well for us over the years. So the broad outlines you can put in for a bank are terrific and have to be adhered to, and you must make sure you adhere to those. I think tweaking around with every piece is hard. For instance, the piece about 3 years going public. You know, you're going to have to invest an awful lot of money in systems and technologies and branches and all of that, and you will not, and that will affect your profitability, frankly, in the first 3 years. So is that the ideal time you want to go public? I don't know. Perhaps if the idea is to give the public, you know, access to those shares at a time when they haven't got too expensive, it may achieve that purpose, but I'm not sure that you can predict these things as well as it's laid out. Last one, you know, I think always if someone is really interested in making the bank very successful, then asking them to dilute, can you imagine what level of interest they will have in doing that in year 10, 9, 10 and 11? just before they have to sell out. Obviously, it should be high because they will want to sell at a high valuation. But will you play for the long term? Will you play for the short term?
But as we were pointing out, I mean, existing banks will need to comply with the same promoter shareholding requirements, in fact, more stringent than what these guys will have.
I agree. But I will also tell you that in those cases also, I think some of these tweaks are very detailed and micromanaging in some respects, whereas I think it should be left at a larger level.
Yeah.
I agree with Pramod on one point. I mean, the going public in 3 years is a challenge, but what it does, in fact, leaves an option open. If you want to raise capital, equity capital, you have an option open.
Okay.
Rather than saying you cannot go public, so it's your call. If you do find that you're capable of doing that, you have an option to raise capital.
All right, I'll come back to you, Pramod, in just a second. Let me go across to Ashwin Parikh and Bobby Parikh, both joining us. Ashwin Parikh, let me start by asking you, the one big takeaway that we've been... Absolutely. So the devil really is in the fine print. Unfortunately, we've completely run out of time. So Religare Bank, is that what it's going to be called?
We'll have to wait and see.
Okay, we'll have to wait and see. Bobby Parikh, Ashwin Parikh, Pramod Basin, Sunil Godwani, and Ajay Srinivasan, appreciate you joining us here on this special discussion on the RBI's guidelines for bank licenses. Dentara, back to you.
All right, thanks, Ashwin, for taking us through that discussion. We're actually going to slip into a short break, but up next on What's On, Wipro Chairman Azim Premji pledges more of his personal wealth to charity, transfer stake in Wipro to the Azim Premji.